Hey there guys, Paul here from theengineeringmindset.com. In this video, we're going to be looking at the induction motor, specifically the three-phase alternating current induction motor. Now the induction motor is the most common type of motor used in industry, and it's used in pretty much everything from elevators, escalators, pumps, fans, conveyor belts, etc, etc. Anything that needs to be moved within a building is probably going to be using one of these motors. And they are very popular because they are relatively cheap, they're pretty efficient, they're easy to install and control, they're low maintenance, and they'll work for many years to come. And even if they do break, you can usually replace these quite quickly with another one from the manufacturer straight off the shelf. And you can see two examples here on the screen. So we've got an induction motor here, a belt driven one, which is driving a fan in an AHU. And then there's another motor here, obviously a much older one, which is directly coupled to a centrifugal pump, and that is pushing water around a heating system. So if you're in engineering or you're looking to go into engineering, then you're going to be coming across these pumps, or these motors, sorry, a lot. So it's a good idea to understand how they work. So if we took a typical induction motor and pulled it apart, these are the main components that we're going to see inside them. So first of all, we've got the main body or the frame, which is this part here. Now this part is bolted down onto the floor or onto a frame. As you can see here, these are bolted down. Now we see the main frame is where everything is kind of bolted into and connected to. So this is the central reference point. It's also the housing for the stator. So the stator fits inside there, and the stator is called the stator because it is stationary. Inside the stator, you'll have all these coils, so they will be wrapped around all these grooves inside the stator, and we'll have a closer look at that just shortly. But the coils are wrapped around the inside frame, all around its inner circumference, and the electricity will flow through these coils, which will be used to generate a magnetic field, and that's what's going to cause the motor to spin. But we'll have a look at that in more detail in just a second. So just looking inside a real example of a motor here, we've got the stator here, all these bars running around, and this is the coils which are wrapped around, making the way around the circumference there. Then running through the center of the motor and the coils is the rotor. This is a shaft with an inductor attached, this part here. The inductor is affected by the magnetic field, and that will cause it to spin. When it spins the shaft, which is mechanically attached to, and this provides the mechanical power that we use to move things. And we're going to look at that also in a second. Now this is a photo of a real rotor. So you can see the inductors here, and this is the shaft running centrally through the middle. And we've also got a set of bearings at each end, and this is connected onto the shaft, and these fit inside the end shields. Now the bearings, they just ensure that the shaft rotates smoothly and with minimal friction. Obviously the shaft is going to spin at a very high angle of velocity. Then on each end we're going to have an end shield, and these will be bolted onto the frame, and that's what the bearings sit inside. And these just protect the inside of the motor from, you know, particles entering, and they also just hold everything in place to make sure that the rotor, when it's spinning, stays where it should do and doesn't fly off and start to hit some of the stators and the coils, etc., damaging the machine. Then at the back, we've got this fan here, and that is bolted directly onto the end of the shaft there, so that obviously when the shaft spins, so there's the fan, and the faster the shaft spins, the faster the fan spins. Now this is an important feature of the motor design. So the fan is going to pull in air, ambient air, and it'll bring it in into the fan blades and then force that across the outside of the fan, taking some of that heat away. And these fins, which are sticking out all the way around, they also conduct some of the heat away from the center. So these will actually increase the surface area, the outside surface area of the casing, and that will draw some of the heat out and allow more air to pass through and give it more opportunity to take some of that heat away. I'll just show you an example there from a thermal imaging camera. So that air is being sucked in from this end here, and that's then being drawn in through the fan and pushed on the outside of the casing to take some of that heat away. And you can see here it's much cooler where the air is first entering, and you can see it's making its way through to this side. There is a bit of a hot spot on this one here, and the rest of the case is warmer, where it's just from the heat from the coils on the inside. And then lastly, at the very back, we've got this fan guard here, and that is really just to protect the fan and also protect you and stop you cutting your fingers off, really. So if we just have a quick look at the rotor. Now, this type of rotor is known as the squirrel cage type, and that's referring to these conductive bars which run along its length, and just because it looks a bit like a squirrel cage, you know, a cage you'd keep a squirrel in. So back in the day, they just decided to call it a squirrel cage. But anyway, the squirrel cage frame has these conductor bars which run from one end to another. They're typically made from copper or aluminium, and they'll have these end rings attached to either end of them, and this will short it, creating a circuit, and that will allow the induced current to flow through it. Now, this creates its own magnetic field within the rotor, within these inductors here, and the magnetic field within the rotor will be repelled by the magnetic field of the stator, and that's what's going to push this all the way around. Now, sandwiched in between these end rings are these very thin sheets of laminated iron. You know, these are maybe half a millimeter thick in the real world. And these are just there to intensify the magnetic field, and they also reduce the eddy currents. You might also notice that these inductor bars are not straight, they're actually skewed. And this is just designed like this because it increases the torque. So there is obviously a maximum skew that you can put on these, and the angle of that skew will depend on the design of the motor. So how does it actually work? Well, when you pass an AC current through a wire, the current alternates between flowing backwards and forwards. That's why it's called an alternating current, or AC. The amount of times it alternates per second is known as its frequency, which is measured in hertz. So you can see here, on each cycle, it's passing between the positive and the negative, which changes its direction. And when you pass electrical current through a wire, we know that it also produces a magnetic field around it. This also changes direction with the alternating current, as you can see here. And the strength of that magnetic field is also going to change with the current as they alternate between its maximum and minimum value. So as it reaches here, the peak, then it's at its maximum there. And then as it passes through the zero line, it's its minimum. And then it maximizes again at its lowest peak also. Now, when you add multiple wires together connected to the same phase, or when you loop the wire, it creates a much stronger magnetic field, and it amplifies this magnetic field. So if we loop a bunch of wires together and then pass a current through them, all the magnetic fields add together, so you get a really strong magnetic field. So if we took the motor housing and the stator, and we made two coils, and we placed them opposite each other in the stator, and we connected them together and passed the current through them, then this will create a pole. So you've got the north and south here, and this will flip between the two coils as that passes through each cycle of the wavelength. So if we then took a three-phase supply and connected each coil to each of the phases and place them at different angles around the inside of the stator, then each one of these coils would receive their maximum power at a different time to each other. And you can see here from the sinusoidal waves here that the red would receive its peak first, then the yellow, and then the blue phase, or line 1, 2, and 3. And that will cause a rotating magnetic field. So as each one of these coils receives its maximum peak value, that pole is going to move around the coil, the stator, and produce a rotating magnetic field. And that's very useful because we can then place the stator inside and use that magnetic field of the stator to drive the rotor. And notice how the magnetic poles of the rotor are now polar opposite of the rotating magnetic field of the stator. And that's repelling it, they're repelling each other. So this is going to spin around as this magnetic field moves around it. So the rotation of the rotor around the stator is what gives us that mechanical drive, which we can then connect pumps and fans to, etc., and use that to spin these plant items. And just to help you visualize there, so obviously if the magnetic field was running around here, then this would cause the rotor here to rotate, and on the end here is what we would bolt onto the fan, etc. I don't know why that's spinning around the wrong way, but anyway, you get the idea. But anyway, that is it for this video. Thank you very much for watching. Please don't forget to like, subscribe and share. And if you have any questions, please leave them in the comment section below and I'll try to answer them as soon as possible. Also, don't forget to check out our website, theengineeringmindset.com. And once again, thank you very much for watching.